Shalom Aleichem, everyone. So we're going to open in prayer. We'll begin with our word for today. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this day, this beautiful Shabbat that you have blessed us with. Lord, this time that you have ordained in our week to be separated from the other days, the holy from the mundane, the 24-hour period of time, Lord, that you call us to come and sit at your feet, to be refreshed and renewed by your presence and your spirit. Father, I lift up this time to you, Lord, that you alone will be glorified, that you alone will be exalted. Father, we ask that you would open up our eyes, our ears, our hearts, and our minds so we could be in a proper position to receive all that you have. Lord, I thank you for this time, Lord, and I pray, Lord, that you alone would be magnified, yes, worshiped, adored, cherished, honored, praised, because you alone are worthy. And I thank you in the name above all the names, that of Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. 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 We've been looking, for the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about spiritual hazards and our awareness to them as a way to protect ourselves from succumbing to such hazardous conditions in our spiritual life and in our walk as believers. And I want to continue today with another spiritual hazard that we need to make ourselves aware of, and that is loving the world. And loving the world is something that we can easily find ourselves becoming a victim of. It's very, very slow moving, and it's something that happens over the course of time, and next thing you know, we see our habits and our lifestyles changing, where we find ourselves loving the world and looking to please the world. And Rav Shaul Paul, in his second letter to Timothy, speaks about a sadness of one of the believers having drifted away from the faith because of his love for the world, because of having stepped into that hazard and being overtaken by it. And we read in 2 Timothy 4:10, "For Demas, because he has fallen in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone off to Thessalonica." And when we talk about loving the world, what we're really talking about is pursuing sin. And when we obtain what we pursue, it doesn't leave us satisfied, it leaves us feeling empty. It's been said that sin will take you farther than you've ever wanted to go, keep you longer than you've ever wanted to stay, and cost you more than you ever wanted to pay. And usually we don't come to this realization until after it's too late. Until after we've fallen in to the lure of sin and are experiencing the consequences of it. And we, as scripture throughout the Bible that warns us about falling in love with the world and the things of this world. And in 1 John 2:15, we read, "Do not love the world or the things of the world. If someone loves the world, then the love for the Father is not in him. Because all the things of the world, the desires of the old nature, the desires of the eyes, and the pretensions of life are not from the Father, but from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires. But whoever does God's will remains forever." So the love of the world is a very real and very serious hazard that we need to be aware of in our walk. It's the kind of hazard that doesn't come with flashing lights and sirens to let you know that it's dangerous. It doesn't have a warning label on it saying hazardous to your health. Instead, it's something that will slowly seep into your lifestyle and will compete with your love and affection and your time for Adonai. Just as we just read in 1 John, it says, that if someone loves the world, then the love for the Father is not in him. Because we cannot love both the world and the Father. And what I want to look at today is the spiritual impact of loving the world and five ways that this takes place. The first one is loving the world will create a desire for materialism. In 1 Timothy 6, we read in verse 7, "For we have brought nothing into the world and can take nothing out of it. So if we have food and clothing, we will be satisfied with these. Furthermore, those whose goal is to be rich fall into temptation. They get trapped in many foolish and hurtful ambitions, which plunge them into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all the evils. Because of this craving, some people have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves to the heart with many pains. But you, as a man of God, flee from these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faithfulness, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you testified so well to your faith before many witnesses." And again, this comes from Rav Shaul in his writing to his student Timothy. He reminds him of the danger of loving this world. And we see the impact that that has when he later writes to Timothy describing Demas and how he had fallen in love with the present world and had left and had gone off to pursue his own desires. And Rav Shaul tells us that there is an utter failure of money that it will give us anything. That is the deception about money and about materialism. As long as we believe that money or material goods will bring us happiness, we're always going to be disappointed. When we love these things, whether it's money or material possessions, we'll soon learn that it's an empty love because it does not love you back. All it does is draw you deeper and deeper into sin and deeper and deeper into despair. It's like quicksand. And loving the material world, it is going to interfere with your ability to love Adonai and love others. And that is part of the fatal war of materialism. You'll never have enough. And that's what we see so prominent in the lives of unbelievers, is the pursuit of materialism, whether it's in the form of money or whether it's in the form of goods and possessions. It will infect you like a unsatisfying drug. You'll never have enough. No matter how much you accumulate, it'll never be enough. You'll still be looking for more. Adonai created us to love people and to use things. But materialism leads us to love things and use people. The world pursues material goods in vain, and material things can never fill a spiritual void, because there will never be a satisfaction. They'll always be looking for more. I remember one time years ago talking to one of my coworkers, and it was some really, really big lottery, hundreds of millions of dollars. And I asked him, I said, "If you won, would you keep on playing?" He goes, "Of course I would." And I was like, "Wait a minute." I said, "This lottery is about $300 million. If you won that, you would still play lotto every week?" He goes, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, why?" "It's because I want to win again." And I said, "But you can never begin to spend all that money in your own lifetime." He says, but yeah, but you still want more. Why would you not play? And you could just see, you know, the mindset here of never having enough. And the scriptures tell us that we're not to pursue the material things of this world. And it's kind of interesting is that we see right in Shemot chapter 20, when Adonai is given Moshe the Ten Commandments, one of those deals with materialism. When we read, do not covet your neighbor's house, do not covet your neighbor's wife, his male or female slave, his ox, his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Of the Ten Commandments, Adonai addresses this issue of materialism because he knows that it's going to lead you down the wrong path and it's going to draw you away from a relationship with him. In Matthew 6:19, Yeshua tells us, do not store up for yourselves wealth here on earth where moths and rust destroy and burglars break in and steal. Instead, store up for yourselves wealth in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where burglars don't break in or steal. For where your wealth is, there your heart will be also. And he goes on to say in verse 33, seek first his kingdom and righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. And it's interesting is that, you know, Yeshua tells us in Matthew 6:21, where your wealth is, there your heart will be. And that is the hazard of loving the world. Because when you pursue the things of this world and you pursue the love of this world, you will not pursue the love of Adonai. Because your heart is in the world, your heart will stay in the world. Your heart will not be for Adonai. It will not be towards loving him. It will not be towards pursuing a deeper walk and relationship with him or coming to know him on a greater intimate level. It will be caught up in materialism, it will be caught up in many other aspects of loving the world. And loving the world is not just talking about money, it's not just talking about materialism, but the spiritual impact of loving the world goes beyond that. This is just one aspect of it, is that it creates a desire for materialism. And the next thing that loving the world will do to you is that by loving the world, you will now lean on human wisdom. And not the leading and counsel of the Ruach HaKodesh. An after effect of loving the world is that you're going to start to lean on human wisdom. And this is how it slowly starts to seep into your mindset, into your thinking, and changing your attitude and your behavior and your life and your walk. Because you start to use human reasoning and logic, which is faulty, instead of pursuing the leading and counsel of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, and His guidance. Because in reality, you know, we say you are what you eat. And there really is truth to that and wisdom found in that. And to take it as one step further, whatever you feed your mind is what you will think and become. Psalm 23:7 tells us that as a man thinks continually in his heart, so he is. And part of loving the world is loving worldly philosophy, which always goes against Adonai's word, which is his will. Because when we start to love the world, we drift from the word of Adonai. We start to think more highly of ourselves than we should. Well, man isn't really all that bad. Man's inherently good. We hear all the time. We just, you know, man is good. He's just, you know, he's got a little couple of quirks and a little, you know, shortcomings. Well, man is not good. Man is evil. Proverbs 3 tells us to trust Adonai with all our heart and not rely on our own understanding. Because that's what the world does. It relies on its own understanding of how things are. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will level your paths. And a level path is a beautiful image because it's who would prefer to walk on a level path as opposed to one that's going to go downhill and then it's going to go uphill and then it's going to go downhill and it's going to, and when he's leveling that path, he makes it easier. When we lean on human wisdom, what we're really talking about is humanism. And humanism is attaching importance to human rather than divine or supernatural matters. When someone becomes humanistic, they try to use their own reasoning and logic to explain away things. And they give no account to the supernatural or divine intervention on behalf of Adonai. A humanist believes and stresses that there is potential value and goodness in humans. But they believe that this potential is found inside of the individual. There is no potential for goodness in a human being apart from Adonai. Because we all sin and fall short of the glory of Adonai. And the heart is wicked and deceitful above all things. So that we, outside of Adonai, there is no potential for man to be good. We're sinners, and we will remain sinners apart from Adonai. Humanism solely seeks to rationalize ways of solving problems. Humanism is constantly trying to remove God from the picture and from the equation. Humanism is going to teach you that you don't need God, that you can solve all your problems and answer all your problems on your own. And humanism is something that is taking over this world, the spirit of humanism. And we see it all the time in movies and in television and in our society and in social media. It's being shoved down our throat. It's being forced in our schools and taught to children. That you can be your own God, that you can solve your own problems, that you don't need help from anyone else. Because all the potential for you to solve your own problems is right here inside of you. And that's the lie from the pit. Because apart from Adonai, we cannot accomplish any good thing. And we are not saviors. We cannot save ourselves. It's kind of interesting. When you look at a lot of movies nowadays, over the past 20 years or so, and you see these movies, whenever you see a movie, and it's interesting because when you see movies today and they're set in a futuristic time, have you ever noticed that you never hear a mention of God or faith in a movie? When people come up with these movies and they're set in these futuristic times, centuries ahead, there's never mention of God. There's never mention of faith or any type of religion whatsoever. These societies that are created in the imaginations of these writers, it's surrounded by humanism. We've outgrown the need for a God because we've developed our own minds and we've evolved into a higher understanding of our abilities and our capabilities and what we are. It's interesting because when you look at these types of movies, there's never the presence of God in these movies. I mean, you can even go back to something like Star Wars, which is, I don't even know how many years old that is. It was the first one, the mid-70s. I've never seen them, to be honest with you. But what they always say, I mean, the main line of these movies is always, "May the Force be with you." But that force is never God. It's just a force. And humanism likes to use that catchphrase, the universe. Because it doesn't give acknowledgement to the existence of God. It doesn't give glory to God. Humanism tries to erase God from every picture. and say, you are able to do it on your own. When we love the world, we will lean on human wisdom, and we will soon depart from the leading of the Ruach HaKodesh. And the scriptures warns us of this. And again, Paul writing to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, he tells Timothy, moreover, understand this, in the Aharit HaMayim, in the later days, will come trying times. People will be self-loving, money-loving, proud, arrogant, insulting, disobedient to parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, uncontrolled, brutal, hateful of good, traitorous, headstrong, swollen with conceit, loving pleasure rather than God. Well, I think we just described today, the society we live in. And this is what Paul, Rav Shaul, warns Timothy about. And again, this all begins with the mindset. And as we grow and nurture a love for the world, we start to drift away from Adonai. Because we're not seeking the counsel of the Ruach. We're not seeking the wisdom found in His Word. We try to seek wisdom through humanism. See, loving the world is, you know, we talk about, you know, do not love the world. It goes beyond just the desire for material things. That's just one aspect of loving the world. But we love the world when we start to look towards human ability instead of seeking Adonai and His ability. As we grow in our love for the world, it will create a desire for acceptance by the world and not from Adonai. And when you think about this, what's really important to you is where you're going to seek acceptance and value. If the world is important to you, you're going to seek and desire acceptance from the world. But if God is important in your life, then you're going to look to seek acceptance and value from Him. So as we grow in our love for the world, we're going to seek approval from the world and the leaders of the world. In a social aspect, we're going to seek prestige, fame, and glory, and false love. Everyone wants to be loved. Everyone wants to be accepted. And as your desire for the world and the love of the world continues down this dangerous path, you're not going to seek love and acceptance from Adonai. You're going to look for it in other people. From an economic standpoint, you're going to desire power and titles and control and domination. When you look at, you know, the world and you look at that Wall Street mentality, for them, it's a game. Whoever's got the most toys wins. If I can get to the top of the corporate ladder and step on everybody on the way up, I'm king of the hill. And people think that by becoming king of the hill that they'll have acceptance and admiration and love of everyone else. So that's why they pursue it. And that's the deception that the world is caught up in. Everyone's trying to get the acceptance and approval of everyone else. So everyone's doing the same thing, trying to step on each other. If I can get to the top, then I'm going to be loved and I'm going to be accepted and I'm going to be worshipped. And I'm going to have the approval and admiration of others. If I'm on the bottom, nobody's going to be admiring or approving me. So I got to be like everyone else in the rat race, and I got to do whatever I have to do to try to get to the top so that I'll win over everyone else. And this is the sickness of loving the world. Because in reality, what you're doing is you're seeking an empty fame and acknowledgement from a lost world. You're striving to be the best of the worst. That's really what you're doing. You're striving to be the best of the worst. Or you're striving to have the most meaningless things out of anyone else. I got more meaningless things than you do. And then that person strives to have more meaningless things than the next person. And then they say, you know, it's the pursuit of meaningless things, the emptiness of the world. Just as we read before, the riches of the world are going to pass away. But as the impact of loving the world is going to create a desire in your heart for acceptance from the world and not from God. And this even goes right down to something like peer pressure that everyone goes through and everyone experiences, regardless of wherever you are in your life, however old regardless of your age. Even when you're young, there's peer pressure to want to fit in, to want to belong, to want to be loved or admired by your peers. So what do? You do what the world does because you want to fit in. You don't want to rock the boat. You don't want to be, a voice that's different. You got to fit in. You got to be part of the crowd. And we succumb to this peer pressure. Instead of being like David and standing out and looking that heathen right in the eye, that Goliath, and saying that you're going to die on this very day because the Lord is going to deliver me into your hands. Instead, we don't want to pick up that sling. We just don't rock the boat. It's more important for me to feel love and acceptance from people than it is for me to feel love from Adonai. So I'm just going to go with what everyone else does. And that's part of the impact of loving the world, is that it will create a desire in your heart to be accepted by the world. I want to fit in with the world. So I'm going to dress like the way the world dresses. Whatever the latest fad is, I'll wear that clothing. Or I'll wear that hairstyle. Or that jewelry, or that tattoo, or whatever it is that'll make me feel like I'm being accepted by everyone else. So basically, you're on a boat that's sinking, and instead of being concerned with saving yourself, your concern is, I want everyone else around me that as we're all going down together to the bottom of the ocean, I want to feel love and acceptance by these people as we sink to the bottom. And this is part of the impact of loving the world. It'll create a desire to be accepted by the world and not Adonai. In James 4:4, he writes, "You unfaithful wives, don't you know that loving the world is hating God? Whoever chooses to be the world's friend makes himself God's enemy." So you can't have both ways, because your heart is going to lean towards either Adonai and relationship with him, or loving the world and trying to appease other people. It's going to create a desire for acceptance. When you succumb to the world, another spiritual impact of loving the world is that you will now become a conformer and not a transformer. When you love the world, you will become a conformer, not a transformer. And Romans 12:2 tells us, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind." So right here in Romans 12, Rav Shaul's writing, and he's saying there's two types of people. There's the conformer and there's the transformer. And he says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And again, our minds are very impressionable. It's going to take the shape of whatever the thoughts dominate it. And the problem with conformity is that you're always changing to adjust to whatever's popular, what's the latest fad. So it's like following the rest of the people that want to do something foolish or look foolish or act foolish or talk foolish. Well, I got to do that too so I can fit in. That's conforming to the pattern of this world. Conformity, you're always adjusting and you're always making changes to whatever's the latest fad. But transformation has its root in a firm foundation. It's not blown about by shifting trends because it's rooted in the Word of God, which is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So it doesn't get tossed around in the waves of, well, what's the latest fad or what's the latest thing that's going on. And the reality is that we were created to be transformers. Transformers are leaders, and they are world changers. Conformers are blind sheep, they're followers. See, it doesn't matter, even if you're the king of the hill in the world, you're still going in the wrong direction, and you're still going to wind up, you're all going to wind up in the same place, which is hell. So at the end of it, it doesn't matter how much you had or how wealthy you were or how popular you were or how much fame you had in the world. When it all comes to a crashing halt, the world is going to be in hell. And it's not going to matter that you were the king of the hill, because guess what? You'll still be in hell with the guy that was at the bottom of the hill. It's not going to matter. You're both going to be in the same place, hell. Eternal torment, eternal separation from Adonai, because of the choices that you make. Conformers are blind sheep, they're followers. Transformers are leaders and world changers. Transformers generate change. Transformers generate growth and creativity. Conformers don't do that. Conformers are going to resist change and they welcome stagnation. Don't rock the boat. Just do what everyone else does. Don't think for yourself. Let somebody else do the thinking for you. There's no growth in that. There's no development. Transformers live a disciplined life. Conformers live a compromising life. Because they're always compromising to meet the satisfaction of somebody else. Transformers experience freedom in belonging to the body of Messiah. That's the right kind of belonging, and there's a freedom in that belonging to the body of Messiah. There's freedom found in there. When a conformer belongs, there's enslavement. Because there's no independent thought. Conformers are slaves trapped in cultic environments and organizations. They just conform. They're just a part of a cult. Why? They just conform. Transformers hunger for the word because it's the food of our spiritual life. As a transformer, you're transforming, you're constantly growing and developing. You're constantly putting off the old and taking on the new. And the only way you put off the old and take on the new is being fed from the word and being in a relationship with the Ruach and with Adonai. That's how you transform. So you don't transform apart from the Word of God and a relationship with Him. You conform, because outside of the Word and outside of relationship with Adonai, you're just part of the world. And the world cannot transform. The world conforms. And that's part of the deception of loving the world. Well, you don't have to, you could be your own person, you can do whatever you want. And that's a deceptive lie, because in the world you don't do whatever you want. Because of peer pressure and other pressures, you're trying to gain the acceptance of others. So what you do in reality is you become a slave and you conform to that latest fad or that latest movement. You surrender your freedom. You're not free. You're in pursuit of the acceptance and the love of other people. But you're not free. And that's where the enemy is flipping everything around on you. The enemy's telling you, oh, you don't want to be, you don't want to, you know, listen to the Lord and, you know, you don't want to follow the word because, you know, then you're restricting yourself. You can't be free. But the reality is true freedom is found in a relationship with Adonai and his word. And enslavement is found in the things of this world. Because they're never going to bring you satisfaction. They're never going to bring you true joy or happiness. They're never going to fill any kind of void. It's just a downward spiral that leads to unfulfillment and despair and eternal separation from Adonai. In 1 Peter 1, we read in verse 14, as people who obey God, do not let yourselves be shaped by the evil desires you used to have when you were still ignorant. Well, what is he talking about still ignorant? Still ignorant to who Adonai is and his word. On the contrary, follow the Holy One who called you, become holy yourselves in the entire way of life, since the Tanakh says, you ought to be holy because I am holy. Romans 8 tells us, having one's mind controlled by the old nature is death, but having one's mind controlled by spirit is life and shalom. For the mind controlled by the old nature is hostile to God because it does not submit itself to God's Torah. Indeed, it cannot. Thus, those who identify with the old nature cannot please God. And the old nature is the worldliness. It's the love of the world. It's the pursuit of the fleshly desire. The spiritual impact of loving the world is that you will become a conformer and not a transformer. And the last one I'd like to share is another impact of loving the world is that it's going to lead to building a spiritual image instead of a godly character. When you love the world, you are going to build a spiritual image instead of godly character. It's being double-minded. And when we go down this slippery slope of creating a spiritual image, it becomes a performance that we put on for an audience. You ever notice spiritual people are always going to let you know how spiritual they are? It's a show that they're putting on for you. They're deceiving themselves and they're trying to deceive you into how spiritual I am. Oh, I'm very spiritual. Meanwhile, they don't believe in God, they don't pray to God, but they believe in the universe and they're very spiritual. I don't want to be spiritual. I'd rather have godly character than spiritual. And we need to be careful as believers in Messiah Yeshua that we don't have an outward life that's different to what we practice in private. We need to make sure that we're not living double-minded. You know, we act spiritual. We put on a show for our fellow brothers and sisters in Messiah Yeshua. And we become spiritual and we put on these big shows. And we raise our hands and we can praise God and do all these things. But then behind the scenes, it's just a facade. And we're living an ungodly life. Godly character is built not by what we do in public, by what we do in private. But if you love the world, you're going to want to build a spiritual image and not godly character. Luke 16:5, we read, he said to them, Yeshua speaking, you are those who justify yourselves in the sight of men, but God knows your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men is detestable in the sight of God. And again, we're talking about the difference between the world and Adonai here. That which is highly esteemed by men, there's nothing godly about it. It's detestable in the sight of God. Titus 1:16 says, "They claim to know God, but with their actions they deny him. They are detestable and disobedient. They have proved themselves unfit to do anything good." See, when we have a love for the world, we'll want to develop spiritual images. And again, what's behind a wanting desire to build a spiritual image is it's to want to make everyone look at me. Worship me. Give me your approval. Give me your attention. Give me your love. Oh, that person, oh, they're very spiritual. And next thing you know, everyone's celebrating how spiritual this person is. When you build a spiritual image, it's all outward. It's about, look at me. Spiritual people talk about who they are and what they do. Be careful of spiritual people. And listen, there are spiritual people within the body of Messiah. Like wolves among sheep's clothing. Be very careful of someone who's very spiritual. Because they're going to talk about how spiritual they are. And then next thing you know, they have a spirit of religion upon them. Be on your guard against people who always talk about themselves and the just tremendous level of faith that they're on. Because that's not godly character. Godly character is not outward. Godly character is inward. Because godly character, we're looking to Adonai. We're not looking at self. Godly character, we talk about who he is. We talk about what he has done in our life and what he is continuing to do. But a spiritual person is going to talk about themselves and all their spiritual accomplishments and, oh, look at me, and you should be impressed by me, and I do this and I do that. There's no humility in that. Because the desire and the intention is to build oneself up above you, their audience. Because they desire to be worshipped and admired. It's the spirit of Hasatan. It's a wolf in sheep's clothing. It's giving this resemblance of somebody that's being holy. Oh, look how spiritual they are. But there's no holiness found in them because it's about them. It's not about Adonai. See, when we talk about loving the world, it goes far beyond just the love and the desire for material possessions or money. It has such a greater impact on our spiritual walk and our spiritual health. It'll influence us in ways that we never imagined. And all of a sudden, we go down that path of loving the world, that subtle path, and then we start to resemble some of these aspects. Suddenly, I was like, you know, yeah, I am conforming. I haven't been transforming. Gee, I'm really not growing in my relationship. I'm not growing in my walk with the Lord. I'm really not the mature believer I thought I was because I'm really not growing and developing. I'm just conforming to the world. And the loving of the world, it's like most things, it's a heart issue because our heart is misplaced. We're seeking and desiring the world like Demas instead of being like Timothy and seeking and desiring the things of Adonai and his ways. And the reality is, you only have one life to live. You know, it's funny because it's like that's the name of a soap opera, One Life to Live, right? But the irony of that, the one life to live is the name of a soap opera. And the irony of that, that soap opera, like every other one, worldliness is magnified and glorified in these soap operas. Everything and anything goes. Everyone's aspiring to be better than the next person. Well, first of all, that's an impossibility because somebody has to be on the top. But everyone's aspiring to be better than everyone else, and that's something that just can't be done. It's endless competition to be the best of the worst. But when you look at the soap opera, or any of them, they're all the same. And what are they doing? They're glorifying pain, they're glorifying suffering, they're glorifying, you know, misery and unfulfillment. Right? You got some girl that finds the guy of her dreams only to find out next week's episode that he's cheating on her with three other women. And you know, where's the satisfaction in that? It's just misery upon misery. It's just the world, you know, just glorified. But the reality is that we all do have only one life to live, and we need to choose how are we going to live that life. Are we going to live that life in the pursuit of the world as a lover of the world? Or are we going to live that life in pursuit of loving Adonai? Because the reality is that both sides don't happily live ever after. Only in the pursuit of Adonai, in a relationship with Him, through Messiah Yeshua, do we have eternal life, and we do live happily ever after. Because our happiness is not found in the things of the world, but our happiness is found in the ways of Adonai. We only have one life to live, and we have to guard ourselves as to how we will live it out. As a lover of the Lord or a lover of the world? So we need to be aware of this spiritual hazard of loving the world. It goes beyond, you know, it's amazing because some people can say, I don't love the world. I'm not a materialistic person. But yet they're doing these other things. These other ways, there's other ways of loving the world that can impact your life. We need to be careful about the spiritual hazard of loving the world and be on the guard against it. And the only way that can be done is continuously keeping ourselves in His Word and in an active relationship with Messiah Yeshua and His Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. That is what will keep us on the right path. That is what will keep us in the right direction, living, truly living the one life to live. There is only one life to live, and that is for the glory of Adonai and the advancement of His kingdom. Because as we read in the very beginning, the riches of this world, the ways of this world, the opinions and the philosophies of this world, and everything that this world fights to stand for, is all going the way of the dodo bird. It is on the path of extinction. People get so caught up in the things of this world and the craziness and the wasted time and the wasted energy of pursuing this world. And it's all passing into extinction. The old world is going to pass away and the new world is coming. And the new world is nothing like the old. Amen. And the insanity of this, of being caught up in this loving of the world, the insanity of it is given illustration. It's like being on the Titanic after it hits the iceberg. And instead of fighting to get to the top of the boat, everyone's fighting to get to the bottom of the boat because they don't get it and they don't understand. They're blind. They're fighting to get to the bottom of the boat instead of fighting to get to the top of the boat and find salvation. This world hit the iceberg when Adam and Eve fell into sin. Bless you. This world hit the iceberg. This world is sinking. The ways of this world is sinking. The philosophy of this world is all going to come crashing down into the depths of not the ocean, but the depths of hell. And the only way out is salvation found only in Messiah Yeshua. In no other way, no other form of salvation is there. Not through humanism, not through any kind of philosophy, not through any acts of spirituality. That's all garbage, and it's all the way of the world. And it's all on a big journey down to hell. And the only way to salvation is in Messiah Yeshua. So as I close, I offer this opportunity for anyone who's never received Yeshua as their Lord and their Savior. You do have a choice, and there is a way. And that way is Messiah Yeshua, who came to die and pay the penalty for the sins of humanity. Amen. So that all can receive salvation and eternal life and be reconciled to the Father. There is only one way, and there is only one true way to live life. And that is in relationship with Messiah Yeshua. Becoming one with Him. And for anyone who has never received Yeshua, I offer this opportunity today to you. Today is the day of salvation. There is no guarantee of a tomorrow. There is no guarantee that you will experience the end of this day either. That is the uncertainty of life. The time is now. The opportunity is before you now. Not an hour from now and not 5 hours from now. But now is the opportunity to come and receive Him as your Lord and Savior. Invite Him into your heart. Ask Him to be Lord over your life. Receive what He has given freely to us. And acknowledge the cost that He paid for it. If you desire to have Yeshua in your life, then follow me in this prayer, this declaration, acknowledging who He is and what He has done and who we are and what we are incapable of, despite what humanism would teach. Dear Heavenly Father, I know I am a sinner. I know I cannot save myself. I acknowledge, Lord, that You have brought and sent Your Son, Yeshua, to die on the execution of stake to pay the penalty for my sin, and that He died on that stake, that He rose again and is seated at Your right hand in glory. And that because of what Yeshua has done, my sins have now been atoned and covered, and I now have reconciliation in a relationship with You possible. And that through Messiah Yeshua, I now have eternal life, never to be separated from You again. I ask Yeshua to come into my heart and into my life. Be my Lord and be my Savior. Teach me and lead me every day so that I may know Your ways. I thank You, Father, for sending Your Son so that all of this may be possible. And I receive Yeshua as my Lord and my Savior. And I thank You for the eternal life that I now have. I thank You for the new beginning that I now have. That I am now a new creation with a new destination. And I thank You for that, and I praise You in the name above all the names, that of Messiah Yeshua. Amen. Amen. Just want to close with the Aaronic benediction. I hope that everyone enjoys the rest of this beautiful day. Amen. Adonai said to Moshe, "Tell Aharon and his sons that when they bless the children of Israel, that they are to do it in this manner. Yivarecha Adonai ve'yishmarecha, yareh Adonai panav elecha ve'chunecha. Yisar Adonai panav elecha Ve'esim lecha shalom. The Lord will bless you and keep you. The Lord will make his face shine upon you, be gracious unto you. The Lord will lift up his countenance upon you and grant his peace. Amen. Shabbat shalom, everyone. Amen.